So, hey everyone, and welcome to another webinar covering some of our newest GraphQL functionality in Tyke. So my name is Matt Tanner. I am a product evangelist here at Tyke, and I'm joined by my friend Travis Johnson today, who is a consulting engineer here at Tyke as well. Travis is going to be helping to show everyone some of the great stuff he's been doing with GraphQL and Tyke during the demo portion. So you'll hear from him a little closer to the end. What are we going to cover today? Well, we're going to cover a few things. So first, we are going to talk about what GraphQL is very, very briefly. For those that aren't familiar, it'll give you a little bit of an overview for it. Then we're going to talk about Tyke's new GraphQL features. We'll do a real lightning round to just show you our favorite features that we want to highlight. Then I'm going to talk to you about Tyke's latest revelation, which is our universal data graph, or our UDG as we like to call it. And then we'll finish off with some demos and also some Q&A. All right. For those who don't know about GraphQL or may know a little about it, let's go over a few key facts. So, first key fact is GraphQL is an open source data query and manipulation language developed at Facebook. And many of you may remember when GraphQL first came out, using it with the Facebook login and Facebook register. That was really kind of the seedling days of it. And now it's really ballooned out. So initially created in 2012, it became public in 2015 and has really ramped up in popularity, as many of us have seen. The language and the services built for GraphQL allow clients to define the structure of data that they want to receive, and the server will return it in exactly that format. So that's really the power of it. It's really, really handy for front-end developers. Now, GraphQL gives you a lot of flexibility and richness, but one of the pitfalls is that sometimes it may just not be worthwhile when you just need a simple API. And lastly here, GraphQL supports reading, writing, and subscribing to changes in data. Basically, anything that you'd be able to do with REST, you're going to be able to do with GraphQL, but it's just a little bit of a different flavor. And this should give you some idea of what GraphQL is. All right, now onto the cool stuff. So now that we have a brief understanding of what GraphQL is, hopefully many on the call will have a deeper understanding of it, let's dive into what we actually built here at Tyke. And as it says in the slide, disclosure, if I get too excited, I apologize. It is some really, really groundbreaking and cool stuff. So let's first look at what GraphQL features we've added. So we've built plenty of new GraphQL features that address many of the concerns of current GraphQL developers and enthusiasts. Essentially, our aim was to make GraphQL easier and more secure. Let's begin to go over all the great features we've added to manage and build great GraphQL endpoints within Tyke. So the first thing that we're going to look at here in terms of API management within Tyke is this batteries included for GraphQL. So using GraphQL but missing all those great features of API management is one of those downfalls. With Tyke, we've actually added support for GraphQL, and you now get all of those batteries included features available to your GraphQL endpoints. And if you're not familiar with batteries included, our terminology on that, feel free to reach out to me or ask some questions at the end, and Travis and I would be happy to fill you in on exactly what those are. But basically, I'm talking about authentication, whitelists and blacklists for IPs, policy creation for GraphQL endpoints, rate limiting, quotas, internal and external API playgrounds, which we'll show you in the demo portion, and the ability to apply API ownership to endpoints, and a bunch of other great Tyke features that you're probably already familiar with in your RESTful implementations. All in all, we are making managing GraphQL APIs much easier. And that was one of the main points of this release. Another great feature to focus in on is field-based permissions. So sometimes you have a large data set, and that can lead to authorization issues, like who should or shouldn't have access to certain fields or objects in your graph. With Tyke, we actually solve that by allowing API owners to customize what fields a user has access to. And then based on that, you can configure those on and off. If you don't want your free users having access to the same data as your paying subscribers, well, that's fine. You can lock out those fields for that user group based on that policy. You don't think that group X needs access to field Y? A few clicks, and you're just going to be able to adjust that so that they no longer have access to that field. It's still going to be exposed in your graph behind the scenes, but the API management platform itself is going to lock that based on the policy. So controlling access to fields is now really simple with this feature. Then we have query depth limiting. So denial of service attacks on GraphQL endpoints are actually really simple to execute. I may have done this a few times while testing one of our test services. So it's very, very easy to do. All you really need to do is deeply nest a query enough that the service will eventually just quit. So how do we get around this? Well, that's where we bring in query depth limiting. With Tyke, what you can do is when a user accesses your GraphQL API, we can actually check to see how deeply nested that query is and put limits on that. So we may say query depth of 3, and if it exceeds that query depth, then the request isn't going to go through. It's all customizable, and it can be done at a global level or per API, which also really helps out too. And it can be set based on who is accessing that API as well. And that's all done through the actual policy. So here's what Travis is going to be demonstrating for us, but I'm going to give you a brief overview of exactly what it's about. So want to build GraphQL without all the work? Well, that's where we brought in UDG. Building GraphQL endpoints on other platforms takes a lot of work and time, and that usually means learning new skills before you even get to the point where you're building production-ready GraphQL endpoints. And this is where we've brought in UDG. So Universal Data Graph, what that's going to do, it's going to allow you to build GraphQL endpoints and requires no code and a minimal learning curve. And when I mean minimal, I mean most of us, after it was actually published from our engineering team, it took us a matter of minutes to figure out how to use it. So it's really, really awesome product, very easy to use. Now, I'm going to go into a little more detail here on exactly what it is. So Tyke's UDG, or Universal Data Graph, is a no-code tool that allows you to build fully functional GraphQL endpoints using existing REST and GraphQL services. Now, as we expand the offering, and we're hoping with some community involvement and feedback, we can really, really balloon this out. We're hoping to add in direct database access and support for other data streams and data sources like Kafka and those types of things. So anywhere that you can access data, we're hoping to be able to plug that into UDG. And basically what you're going to end up with is a unified data graph, if you're familiar with the term, and it's going to leverage those services and endpoints that are already existing. Now, how does it work? This part, I want to go into just a little deeper just to make sure that everyone fully understands it. And then when you go through the demo portion, you'll really be able to see what's going on in the background. So now you're probably asking how it all works, because a lot of us are familiar with these, you know, drag and drop type of things and not really knowing what goes on, but it just works. Well, you know, it's a little more simple from a UDG perspective. We can lay it out quite easily. So using your existing REST and GraphQL endpoints, you're able to expose a single GraphQL endpoint, which allows access to the data in those services. You can do that by schema stitching, and we put quotes around that. What it allows you to do is Tyke will actually handle where to grab the data from. So it's gonna let all those incoming queries or mutations, Tyke handles all of that through the graph, and we'll go out to those data sources and either retrieve or manipulate that data based on that. So let's look at some diagrams of how this would actually work. And what you'll see is the one on the left here, you'll see that there's a UDG GraphQL schema. And when you're in our universal data graph portion in the dashboard, you're going to be able to build a schema. And what that does is you define what you want your schema to look like. And that's what you see here in this picture. And Tyke, you then use Tyke to assign a data source to each of those fields. And that's what you'll see: REST endpoint A response and REST endpoint B response. And if you look at how it pulls it all together, you'll see that field A and field B are coming from endpoint A, and field C and D are coming from REST endpoint B, but your users won't actually see that. They will actually just see that you have a GraphQL endpoint there. So what really goes on, let's say we wanted to stitch together a couple of different things like a GraphQL endpoint and add some supplemental REST data source data as well. Well, this is what a query would look like here on the right. Your users would actually issue a query like this, and they may grab code and name. Tyke will handle this. Tyke will grab the code and name from the GraphQL data, source, and it's going to grab population from a REST data source, but that is not visible to your actual users. All they're going to do is execute the query. Tyke then deals with stitching all of that together based on the way that you've configured that service. Now let's move on to the last part. So what will you build? We've done a lot of stuff lately with this. We have customers who are playing around with it. There's a lot of really cool things coming out of it. So thinking about your current organization, where do you see an area where GraphQL and UDG might be able to help you out? We'd love to hear about your ideas or even help you to make them come to life. And Travis is going to show you a great example of how we can use multiple REST endpoints to really create a practical use of UDG. Now we'll jump into a demo. So for those of you not familiar with the Tyke dashboard, this is what it looks like. If you're using an older dashboard, you may think it looks a little different than what you're using. This is our 3.0 release. So there's a lot of UX and UI improvements that you'll see here. Let's dig right into it though. So if I wanted, let's say I had an existing GraphQL service that I wanted to put Tyke in front of to actually leverage some of that API management. Very, very simple to do. You'll see here that I already have one set up, but I'm going to show you how to do it anyways. I would do add new API. I'm going to call it, I'll just put GQL API. And I would then click off GraphQL, which has the type. Now, here's the part that you'll need to be particular on. So proxy to an existing GraphQL service. And what I'm going to use is, this would be where you plug in your GraphQL service that you've already created. I'm going to use this Trevor Blades countries endpoint, and I'm going to create that under this GQL API. Now, I'm not actually going to go through and configure this right now, but what you would do is configure API. And well, we can go through it anyways. And then you come down here and you'll see that all the stuff that you'd normally see with a API, RESTful API, is available here. So the most important thing for us right now would be this authentication token. We can set our authentication mode instantly, adding in authentication into our GraphQL endpoint without any code needed. But really, we're also able to do something cool here through the API playground. So many of you may be familiar with the graphical interface that might be on the SpaceX GraphQL endpoint or the GitHub endpoint for GraphQL. Well, you can actually expose something like similar to that as well through Tyke, and that is this enable API playground, which then exposes a playground on this path, and then you can have external developers actually come and use it and play around with your API. So let's move on past this. I've already created one exactly the same way. which is this new GQL API. And let's just take a look at what it looks like. I've turned on the API playground for the developers. And then I've also set it as an authentication type of authentication token. And what you'll see is I can actually access this through a, and let me just take out one of these. You'll see that I can access it through the endpoint. So what's happening here is I've set up a GraphQL endpoint in the same way that I just showed you. And I've exposed a playground. Now, when I hit the gateway at port 8080, you'll see that I'm hitting new GQL API, which is my endpoint. I can actually issue queries against it. It will then proxy that to the GraphQL service. Now, this is the simple way of doing it. So let's take a quick look at what our policies would look like. Let's say I want to add some security to this. How would I do that? Well, the first thing that I did was I turned on authentication token here. So now I have an auth token being enforced. The next thing is to create a policy for that. So how you would add a policy for the GraphQL endpoint? Quite simple. You'd pick your GraphQL API, and then you could say create policy. Now I need to add other GQL policy is what I'll call this. My keys will never expire, and I'll create policy. And we'll do update and go back to policy management. And that's how simple it is to add a policy. Same thing if you're putting in a policy on a RESTful endpoint. But how would we configure this policy to do those field-based permissions and the query depth limiting that I mentioned in the first part? Well, let's take a dive into that. So this is a policy that I've created, new GQL API. You'll see here that I have set per API limits and quota, and I also have field-based permissions. Let's first start with query depth. So that's making sure that we don't have any of those denial of service attacks by limiting how deeply nested the query can go. What I'm going to do is I'm going to turn this on, say yes. I could do rate limiting here as well. Could do throttling, do quota here. I won't do any of that today because I think a lot of people are already familiar with how that works. But let's look at the query depth. So here is our query depth portion on the screen. You'll see that right now I have unlimited query depth. That means if I come back to this here and I uncomment this nested query, which I commented out before, I'll uncomment it quickly. Obviously very redundant. So let's try and see if how long it takes for this query to go through. I won't actually perform a denial of service on this endpoint. I don't want to do that because it takes a few minutes to come back up. But let's see how long this takes. So we saw how quickly the first one came back. It was almost instant. If we run this now, you'll see that the time it takes is quite a bit longer. And this is nested. So you'll see countries, countries, countries. Very deeply nested query. And it's still running right now. So we're giving the service in the background a little bit of a workout. This is not necessarily what you want to have happen. So let's figure out how we can combat against that. Here's where I would actually do my query depth. So let's say I had a query depth of, let's put in 3. And what I'll do is I'll update this policy. Now, you'll see that I am using this policy right now, and you'll see that I have my token down here, which is the auth token for that policy. Now, if I run this, I should get a different result. And you'll see depth limit exceeded. So that means that now we're actually stopping this request from going through at the gateway itself instead of letting the service just take the brunt of it. Now, if we wanted to get this to work, what we need to do is take out, I believe this should work for us. Let's see here. Should work for us. One sec, one more. Back. We'll just do a name. And now we should get that back. So you can see that we're able to limit the amount of depth that we have on these queries. And that's huge in terms of making sure that your service is secure and not really exposed to those denial of service attacks. So that would cover off that portion. Now let's take a look at the actual, come back in here. Let's take a look at adding some field-based permissions, which is another feature that I had mentioned to you for managing your GraphQL APIs. We'll come here and you'll see that based on the schema that gets brought back, which we do an introspection query that pulls back the schema, you'll see that all the types that are available are going to be available right here. And then all the fields for those individual types are on the side here. Now, let's say under query, actually, what do we have in our query here now? We have name. Let's say we do code here as well, because that's another one that I know. Now, if we take code, and let's say we don't want our users to have access to code. The user of this policy, we do not want them to have access to it. Maybe it's sensitive data that we don't want them to have. Let's come back in here. And under country, you'll see that we have code. I'm going to uncheck that, and that should make it unavailable to this user. Now I will update this. Updated that policy. Now let me come back to this here and try and issue this query with code in it. Now you'll see field code is restricted on type country, which is why that is not working. Now, that's great. I've now stopped the users from getting that. Let me take that code away, and then I'm able to rerun that query, no problem. So that pretty much covers off the newer additions for Tyke's GraphQL API management. Now I'm going to pass it over to Travis to actually take care of showing you exactly what Tyke's Universal Data Graph is able to do. And Travis, I'm going to stop sharing my screen and I will let you take the reins and take us on the journey through the Universal Data Graph and your example with these REST endpoints.
Awesome, will do. Thanks, Matt. All right, before, like as Matt said, we're now going to go down the path of stitching together existing RESTful APIs. This is a great tool for when you have multiple related backend services and you want to reduce the overall number of API calls you're having to make and manage. Before we go down the path of actually creating this API and creating this universal data graph, I want us to take a look at the services that we're trying to stitch together for this example. If you look here, we have the JSON placeholder website. It's just a freely available collection of RESTful web services just used for testing and prototyping. What we're going to be looking at is their available services for their discussion forum. Provides dummy endpoints for users. These users in turn have posts. Those posts in turn have comments. And each of these endpoints is its own API. So if we take a look here, we have our users for our users endpoint. Here we're looking at post. And we see that each post has a user ID corresponding to the user that created that post. And what we want to do, and I guess let me talk about the problem first, is consuming these endpoints as is in a RESTful fashion, it's going to require multiple API calls to display this data in a relevant way. For example, you first have to query the user endpoint to get the user you'd like to see. You then have to take that user's ID, use that ID to query the user's post. If you want to see comments on that post, you have to take the ID of that post to go grab the comments on that post. So you see, it's a cascading set of calls that someone would have to make in order to pull back those kind of details. So I just want us to now take a look at how we'll make something like this much easier and simpler in Tyke. So I'm going to create a new API here in Tyke. From our top, I'm going to select GraphQL. And instead of proxying to an existing GraphQL service like Matt showed you, I'm going to actually compose a new GraphQL service. And I'll just call this discussion forum UDG. All right, we're going to configure this API. Just for simplicity, I'm going to remove authentication. just so we're not having to mess about with that. And if you look here, we're going to go to the schema tab. We don't have a default schema, so we have to define one. So if we look at the user type, for a user, we have an ID, a name, username, and email. So we want to actually create a corresponding type here in the schema. And we're also going to define a default query as well. All right. And now that we have a user type defined and a default query defined, we now need to define the data sources so we can tell the resolver how to actually resolve a user. So if I go to data sources, click on the pencil icon next to user, I can edit the data source for user. Now, if we look here at types, we have type REST and type GraphQL. Both of these are for existing services that have already been protected in proxy and type. We also have REST and GraphQL, which are for external services. And also, as Matt mentioned, in the future, we'll be adding additional data sources as well for things such as databases and Kafka streams. But for this example here, we're just going to be using REST. And now we want to define a user. So if we look at our user's type, this shows us all users. But if we wanted to grab a specific user, it's user slash then that user's ID. Then we get information just for that user. So we want to take this logic and apply it to the data source. So here for the URL, going to paste in JSON placeholder, which is just a URL we just accessed in the browser. And I just appended this bit here, .arguments.id. What this does is .arguments allows you to access the query arguments of the query that we defined in the schema. Let me just update field. Now that the field's been updated, you see here next to user, we have this REST icon indicating that now we have a RESTful data source to serve users. Now, if I go back to the schema, now I was referencing .arguments, it is allowing us to reference this ID field here. So now that I actually have the data sources defined, I should be able to run this as a query. So now if we go to the playground, again, this is the internal playground. And now having now have the data back for user ID 5. So just that quickly, we've taken a RESTful endpoint, overlaid it with a simple graph that we could query, and now we're pulling back user data. Now, if I want to expand on this example just a bit, I actually want to pull back the post for this user. Now, if we look at the post type, we see post has a user ID, the post has an ID itself, and we have a title and a body. So just like we did for user, we want to add this to our schema. So go to schema, add it in that post. And since posts belong to users, we're actually going to add post to the user type. So it's going to be a post type with an array of type post. So now that this has been added to the user type, again, we have to go back to data sources so we can define for the resolver how to pull back user post. I'm going to click on the pencil icon so I can edit the data source for post. Find the data source. And you see, it pulls up previous templates that we defined just so we could leverage those if we want to. So let me go ahead and select that. Now, let's look at the URL for this data source. We need to pull back post. And if we look at this URL, it's the JSON URL slash users slash the user ID. slash post. So what we see on screen are all of the posts for user ID 5. So to infuse this into the data source, take off that arguments, and we're going to use a new notation here. So dot object dot ID. And what that does, it allows us to access any of the fields of the current object that we're in. So since we know it's slash user ID, we're going to be using this ID here, injected into the URL to pull back their post. So hit update. We have our RESTful icon here to indicate that we now are servicing this with a RESTful data source. Let's go back to the playground to see if we can actually pull back post. This is my post query. Fantastic. So now we have user data, and for user ID 5, we now have all of her post as well. Now we'll take this one step further. Just for emphasis here, now we want to actually pull back comments for the post. And you'll look at the URL format here. It's JSON placeholder slash comments, and there's a query parameter passing in the post ID. So let's go back to our gateway, or should I say to the dashboard. Come here to the schema. We need to add the comment type. And since comments belong to post, just like we did for the user type previously, we now want to add this to the post. So it's going to be a comments property. And it's going to be an array of type comment. And you can probably tell where I'm going with this. Now we need to define the data source for it. So on the post type, we want to edit the data source for comments. We can use one of the existing templates. And now for the data source, or for the URL, same as what we did previously, except now the post ID is going to be .object.id, which will take the ID of the post and pass it into the URL. We can update field. And now I should be able to issue a query that pulls back the user, their post, along with the comments. Drop in my new query. Fantastic. So now you see we have comments, users, and the post, all with a single query. So we've taken what would have been a cascading series of REST calls and have stitched them together into a single graph.
Yeah, and I think it's important to note that from a GraphQL perspective, the nice part is that you may have, one department, let's just say, who only needs maybe the user information, and then another department may need user information and the post. The great part about GraphQL is the fact that you can have both departments using that same endpoint, but you really get to customize what comes back so they can define what they need. And that's the beauty of GraphQL, is being able to do that. And this is a great showcase, Travis, of showing us how UDG allows us to very quickly stitch together these RESTful endpoints into a nice, really sleek GraphQL endpoint.
Awesome. Thanks for the additional context, Matt. And I think I may just demo the bit to where we can actually see some of what you just described, being able to limit the view of what's able to be retrieved. You touched on this a bit earlier with your proxying to an existing GraphQL service. So I just want to show how that same logic applies to when you create your own universal data graph as well. So if we just go back to core settings, I'm going to now enable authentication. Update that. I will create a policy that gives us access to that API. Since now we've secured it with a token, we're going to need a token now to access it and pull any data back. So the API name is going to be my discussion form API. We'll leave the default as is. Set this key to never expire. And this will be my forum policy. And inside of the forum policy, for the example of where you wanted to restrict the data that a particular user could pull back, for example, if you had a third-party service that could query forum data, but you wanted it to actually anonymize the users so they can pull back the content, but none of the user details that would identify the user. In the field-based permissions, we can simply untick the name. So name can't be pulled back, email. Same thing on post, we're gonna take the user ID. And we're gonna take the name and the email from the comment. That's been applied to the policy. So now let's create a key with this policy so we can actually call that our API. All right, let's create a key. Awesome. So we navigate back to our API. Back to our playground. First thing you noticed, authorization field is missing. That's because we've added an auth token for authentication. So if we add in the key that we just created. Awesome, we still get an error, but it's a different error now. Field name is restricted on type user. So the name field that we restricted, you see the user can't get any data back because they're trying to request that field. So if I remove all the fields, user ID is restricted on post. So we take the user ID out of post. And I think there's one more name and email here on comments that we also restricted. Awesome, now we're able to get back all the data that we have access to. And this is for the scenario where they can pull back forum data, but you did want to anonymize who the users were. So just an example of how you can limit the data that users can see and all using the same endpoint. Any questions about any of that?
Yeah, we'll open up the floor. And if you do have any questions, feel free to just type them in the chat and we can handle them one by one. That's a good question. Travis, I think we discussed this the other day. I know, I'm pretty sure Jens has discussed this with us. Actually, Jens is on the webinar as well. He might be the best guy to ask. Jens, oh yeah, let's enable your audio. Yeah, perfect.
Hey, Jens. Guys, can you hear me?
Yep, we can.
Awesome. Yeah, I'm the technical director. It's like responsible for actually building that. So I guess I should answer that question. Can we add caching on the data sources? So currently, this is our first initial launch where we just want to get the initial feedback from the community. So we haven't shipped that already, but the engine is exactly designed to do this. So we already plan to do it. It's just a matter of time when we implement that, and we definitely want to have that, yeah.
Okay, awesome. So it's in the books. We've got a heck of a backlog of things that we're going to be implementing over the next little while. And I guess that's one that's on there. So hopefully, Christian, that answers your question. So it's not currently able to do that, but we will be bringing that in the coming months, hopefully.
By the way, one thing I could add here is, so with Tyke REST APIs, for example, the current way we have implemented REST APIs is you can already cache REST APIs. So what you could do is you add your REST API as a just add it to Tyke, make Tyke manage it. And then it's possible to add caching there. And then you use this defined data source within Tyke. You use that within UDG as a data source, and that way you already have caching. So it's possible. It's not just like super native, but it works. And in the future, we will improve that.
Yeah, and Travis, while you have your screen up, maybe we could show them just how simple it is to you know, select a Tyke REST data source. We don't have to implement it, but we can just show them that how easy it is to do.
Yeah, absolutely. We'll call this test REST. There's a caching option.
There is. I'm trying to remember where it is.
I think caching is on the endpoint designer where you can add the cache middleware.
Yep, it is. Yeah, and then just saveful.
Yep, that's been saved. So now any gets on the root relative path, the responses should be cached.
Yep. And then do you want to just show maybe how on your GraphQL API they have there, just show the, even though you're not going to be able to obviously stitch the data source over, just show how easy it is to select Tyke REST, and then it'll pop up and show exactly which ones are available.
Oh yeah, absolutely. I'm going to save that.
I mean, this is really simple. If you already have all of your REST APIs that you're going to be using for stitching, if they're already all available within Tyke, then you're going to be in really good hands. So I think, yeah, there you go, Tyke REST. Yeah, so you'll see that it's available under Tyke API. So you can just select it right from there. And then as Jens had mentioned, if you're able to do caching on that, then, I mean, obviously it's not super native, but it'll still work for the same purposes. Awesome. Thanks for that, Travis. Thanks for showing us. And Jens, thanks for coming on and helping us out with that. All right. Well, if you do have any questions that pop up, you can feel free to reach out to any of us here at Tyke. So whether it be Jens, Travis, or myself, or we have lots of social media channels to also get a hold of us on too. So yes, please forward your questions, and we'd love to hear about the stuff that you plan to build or are building with UDG. So until next time, we will see everyone later. And have a great week.